very different with any artist you work with. Back in those days, though, bands, you know, there are a lot more bands than there are now. And bands tended to think of studios as being these sort of, well, they'd never been to studios. So they had no knowledge of a recording studio. So my job as a producer was to make them feel comfortable making their music and to help give them a sound, really. And for me in those days, I was quite opinionated about how I thought U2 should sound. So I think over the years they have decided how they should sound more. But in those early days, you know, I was much more powerful in defining the sound because I had more experience, you know. So on the first album, I set them up in a very peculiar way. Thinking back, it was not how you would normally set up a band to do their first album, but they wanted to do it in a studio in Dublin, and no classic rock album had ever been made in Ireland. I'm very proud to have made the first classic album from a rock band out of Dublin, because bands like the Boomtown Rats and Thin Lizzy had both gone to, and Taste, another band, had all gone to England to make their recordings. But U2 wanted to make their first recording in Dublin, so I set the band up very differently because the studio was not so good for rock music. I met them at a gig in the west of Ireland, and I was picked up at the airport by a man called Mr. McGuinness. Now, my thought was Mr. McGuinness would have, you know, being Irish and Guinness being an Irish drink, and Ireland being a very sort of country sort of a place, I thought he might be picking me up on a tractor to go and take me to the gig. But he was this wonderful man with a wonderful English accent. And he just, in the car ride to the concert, he just tried to sell me this band that he was working with. Now, he was playing me some demo tapes that were not very great recordings, you know. But when I saw them live, I absolutely got them. I understood their passion. I understood their ambition right from the very beginning. You know, what they didn't have in those days was much of a personality. They were these sort of 17, 18 year old kids who were just sitting there but when they got on stage, that was when they really became the people that we know, you know. But when off stage, they were sort of empty shells waiting to get a personality. That's not a very nice thing to say, but, you know, when you're that age, you don't have much of a... You're too shy, you know. But when they got on stage with the loud music behind them, they became men. But when they were off stage, they were definitely boys. Boy was... and is one of the great debut albums of all time, and I feel very proud that I was very much leading the band along the way, because they, you know, they had their songs, but they weren't quite sure how they wanted them to sound, and I suppose, you know, they could have sounded a little bit heavy rock, but we really made sure that the sound was less heavy rock, less straight, and always art, you know, always trying some experimental little things, very proud of that album. I didn't want to work on October. I thought at that time that it was only right for a, you know, because I, as a producer, could work with lots of acts, you know. I could make 6-7 albums a year, which I did in those days, but a producer could only work with one producer. Why shouldn't a producer work with more, why shouldn't an act work with more producers? So I always said, even after the first album, guys, go and experiment. Maybe down the line I'll come back and work with you. So it was actually only after Toward a Boy that they asked me back, and I came back for October. But then after October not being so successful, I did say yet again, you know, now's the time for you to go and work with someone else. And they said, yeah, maybe you're right. So they did go and try working with some different producers. Luckily for me, none of them were particularly successful collaborations. And then I remember getting a phone call from them saying, Steve, what are you doing in September? I went, nothing. They said, do you want to come and produce our third album? And I said, oh, I would love to. And the good news about the continuity has always been, we always wanted to try and do something different. We didn't, you know, I think when the band went on the road for October, they became a lot heavier, a lot more rocky. So, and they were influenced by wanting to be, by translating the power. I mean, not so much the power of the guitars, actually. It was more the power of the vocals. I remember Bono saying, I sung my heart out on October, but no one ever said to me, the vocals are great on that album. You know, so we, you know, when it came to War, we really tried to make it, you know, I remember Bono saying to Edge, don't sound like The Edge, sound like Mick Jones from The Clash. You know, and poor Edge was going, what should I do? But we really pushed ourselves on War album, and luckily we managed to get a couple of hit songs, and yeah, it's a really great album. You know, I've known the band 40 years nearly, so they've gone from boys to you know, young men to middle-aged men, and now arguably we're entering the twilight of our life. And Twilight, that was a great song. They've done albums in many different ways. One album they would go into the studio and jam for 15 minutes, just jam anything, and then choose a little section of that. They've never done it again since that album. I think that was, I can't remember what that album was now. Oh my God. But yeah, every album has started and finished, well, they've all finished the same way, completely crazy, but they've all started differently, you know. And so the creative process, yeah, I mean, Edge wrote Sunday Bloody Sunday, you know. Edge wrote Pride in the Name of Love, you know. But, you know, Bono writes a lot as well. Bono writes all the melodies and the lyrics. And but they all have to agree. That's the big thing. It really is a democracy, you know. All the band have to agree on everything, which is why it takes such a long time, because they have such high standards. Well, you know, Atomic Bomb was probably the lowest. They were so low when I came in on that album. They'd been working for 18 months and didn't really like what they'd done, and they felt like they were nowhere near getting an album, and they were very depressed. There was a lot of negative energy, and maybe they don't even remember that now, but it was. You know, they had to let a producer go, and they had, you know, before, up until that point, they'd never had to really let a producer go. They would just add producers to the mix. And there was a lot of low energy. So, you know, good old Jolly Steve walked into the studio and I think maybe raised their spirits a little bit. And we ended up, you know, getting Vertigo, and there were some good tracks on that album. Maybe we just, once we'd finished Vertigo, we thought, oh my God, finally, you know, we've got a hit single. So let's finish the album. And, but no, it turned out very good. It won Album of the Year. So I got Producer of the Year that year. So at the Grammys, so very happy. Remember No Line on the Horizon also being quite an unhappy time at the end. The thing about an Atomic Bomb was that at the end it was good. You know, we turned it round. But because there was a whole new team of players. You know, I brought in my own team. I was like a manager changing at a football team. Not just the manager changed, but the backroom staff changed as well. But with no line on the horizon, I was brought in, added to the mix. And I remember every week, you know, no one was that interested in listening back to the songs. That was something that really made me think that it was not ready yet, and it was unfocused. You know, I remember no one really listened to the songs. It wasn't like they were happy to listen to their music. And even Edge, who is sometimes the most, he is just like, he never stops listening. He is always working on the songs. I think even he sort of decided he couldn't see the wool from the wood from the trees. Maybe he couldn't. I will never say anyone gives up, you know, but it was certainly, it could have been worth a 3-month break and then coming back to those songs and realizing that some of them were too long. Some of them were not good enough. Some of them needed re-recording, you know, just a 3-month break and then coming back with fresh, you know, because hindsight, you know, when you look back on something, it's much easier to know that you've made a mistake than when you're right in the middle of it. And we were just, I don't know, I think there was pressures to carry on, you know, going out on the road and all that stuff. Anyway, that's not really part of my job with them, but it just didn't feel at any point on that album that it was really, that we were really making headway, you know. Red Hill Mining Town was an absolutely amazing experience for me because I'm now living in Indonesia, in Jakarta, and when they sent me the files, because I worked on the original version back in the day, so turning up, you know, putting the tape on, you know, opening the files now and hearing the band talking between takes and listening to that song was a trip down memory lane. And then Bono saying he wanted to re-record the vocals in the verses. You know, that was quite amazing. It was fantastic, really. And all these lovely people working in my house in Indonesia suddenly heard U2 for the first time, and they all went crazy. They loved that song. You know, I think that song could be a huge hit in Indonesia. I am working on the Joshua Tree live shows. I don't know if there's anything I can really say about that because the band are, you know, it's up to them to make any. And, you know, I'm never really allowed to comment about things before they're finished. Once they're finished and they're out, obviously the band has given them given it their blessing. So, no, yes, I just say I have been working on the Joshua Tree concerts, but that's all I'm allowed to tell you right now. But I have to say, it's pretty good. Shouldn't be here cause I should be there. I can see the lights in front of me. I believe my best days are ahead. Live shows, I've always, you know, for many years I was very, very, a little bit depressed when I would come and see songs live that, you know, that in the studio were very difficult to get good. And then they go out and play them live and they're so much better. And I go, shit. You know, oh, I really want to record this song again because they're doing it so well now because they've had time to rehearse it as a song. So a few years ago, I said, boys, you know, why don't you go out and play songs live first and then go in and record them because then you'll know how they go. So they actually did that, you know, song called Glastonbury they played live a few times, but nothing was ever really. It didn't work. I think by that point they'd become too big a band and too self-conscious to play a song live to get it better. You know, they have to have had a recording of it, then they copy the recording, then they get it better. I think that's how it now works for them. But no, it was my idea for them to do, you know, to play songs live to get an idea of how they would sound. But that never really worked. I worked on Songs of Experience. That was my role in the same way as, you know, when I've had three roles with the band. One is as the sole producer, which is Boy, October and War. Another one was when I took over the production, which was on Dismantle an Atomic Bomb. My third role was what I did on Joshua Tree, Achtung Baby, All That You Can't Leave Behind, No Line on the Horizon and Songs of Experience, which was to come in and as an addition to the team to help finish it, you know. And in some cases it worked really well. On the Joshua Tree especially, I was very happy. And All That You Can't Leave Behind was great as well. I worked on Beautiful Day and Walk On. Didn't work so well on No Line on the Horizon. And Songs of Experience, you know, I'm very proud of You're the Best Thing That Ever Happened to Me. I suppose it's not a serious U2 song, and perhaps people want U2 songs to be a little bit more mysterious and serious, you know, like in the early days. But no, it was great, and there was a lot of love on that album. We've known each other now way more than half our lives, and we have a lot of experience together and a lot of love for each other. Obviously, the band have always wanted to change from everything. You listen to Boy, to War, to the Joshua Tree, to Achtung Baby, to Pop, to When Love Comes to Town, you know, all that stuff. It's every time it's different. And, there has been some talk that, you know, perhaps instead of just making it going for the more modern sound, just make records that they like, you know, make their music so that they all like. And that's pretty much how they've all done it, you know. But Bono's very ambitious, and, you know, he looks at the charts and goes, why am I not in the charts? And, you know, maybe one of the reasons that is because the charts are filled with songs that that don't have guitars, that don't have a band playing on them. And so in that case, it's a little bit different. They're getting older, and I don't know. But they always try, and they will always try, you know, because music, they're Irish, and music's in their blood, and they have to make music. I said earlier, there's not much I can say about the future because it's up to them to say what they're going to be doing. But, you know, I've heard that they have some great songs that are unfinished in the bag. So, and, you know, they don't sit around for very long. So who knows what's going to happen? But I don't. And it's not even my job to speculate. Oh, if U2 called me from the moon, I would book Richard Branson's space shuttle, and I would go there to work with them. They are some of my closest friends, even though we don't talk very often. But, you know, they've been there for me in dark times, and there have been some dark times. And I've been there, hopefully, for them in some dark times in their life as well. So that they've allowed me to have a lovely life, and I love them sincerely, and it's been a great ride, and long may it continue. Thank you.